We are back, and you're listening to The Critical Hour on Radio Sputnik. I'm your host, Dr. Wilmer Leon. In the context of its poor planning and utter failure, some see this attempted coup, most recent attempted coup in Venezuela, as a new Keystone Cops Bay of Pigs. The last attempt to overthrow the government of Nicolas Maduro failed spectacularly, as both American and Venezuelan paramilitaries were immediately overwhelmed when they came into contact with the Navy or even with armed local fishermen's collectives. What are we to make of this? Well, for insight, we turn to my next guest. He's a frequent collaborator with all major news outlets and author of City Builders and Vandals in Our Age, Caleb Maupin. As always, Caleb, welcome back.
Sure, glad to be here.
You know, I find this, it's one thing to run up against the Navy, but when you run up against a boat full of armed local fishermen, that should let you know that the people that you're trying to engage are about business. We talked about this last week, but now a few more details have come to light. So I wanted to get your take on what transpired earlier last week in Venezuela.
Well, it appears that U.S. military contractors were trying to put Juan Guaido into power in Venezuela, and they were trying to pull off a coup. They were working with military defectors from Venezuela, and they tried to pull it off, and it didn't go so well. And now we have two U.S. citizens in Venezuelan custody. They are military contractors. We have a number of the coup plotters who've been arrested that are Venezuelans themselves. And it looks like they fell on their face. It looks like this coup attempt, yet another coup attempt, it's certainly not the first time they've tried to violently overthrow Maduro and install a pro-Wall Street regime in Caracas. And yet again, it has failed. And the population of Venezuela is well mobilized to defeat an invasion. They weren't able to kill Maduro with a drone as they attempted to send a drone to a public military ceremony. Other coup attempts have failed, and it looks like Maduro is stronger than ever, despite U.S. efforts to isolate the country, despite economic warfare, despite ongoing destabilization attempts. Venezuela remains strong, and the base of support of the Bolivarian government in Venezuela is now growing in the face of increased hostility from the United States. At first, U.S. leaders were trying to convince the Venezuelan people that the food shortages, the problems that they've had over the past 2 years, are all caused by Maduro and socialism and would just go away if they adopted the free market system and abandoned socialism. But clearly that's not the case. And meanwhile, we've seen an increase in Russian and Chinese investment in Venezuela. We've seen Venezuela make real progress in dealing with some of the problems they had after the dramatic oil price drop. So it looks like Venezuela is not going to be falling anytime soon.
What about the reports that the two gringos, as they were referred to, former Special Forces operator Luke Denman and Aaron Berry, who apparently brought their passports with them and even their veterans discount cards, were reported by some to have worked in some security capacity with President Trump. Any insight there?
Well, it's interesting that in light of that information, Mike Pompeo still denies any U.S. government involvement. Now, he didn't deny any involvement. He said he denies direct U.S. involvement. So, you know, but even that admission seems to indicate that there's probably the hand of intelligence agencies, probably the hand of, you know, special forces and others in this. But yes, they're not active.
Well, so what
personnel.
Wait a minute, Caleb. So what that really means is, Pompeo called a guy who called a guy.
Right. If Pompeo had called them directly, then it would have been direct involvement. But he called a guy who called a guy, so clearly the U.S. government has nothing to do with it. But yeah, I mean, it's pretty wild. And yet, despite denying any involvement, now Pompeo is adamant that these two Americans be returned. You know, you have to wonder if, you know, foreign nationals from another country came to the United States and were attempting to violently overthrow the government and engage in terrorism. You know, and we said, you know, that maybe their home government had nothing to do with it, but wanted them immediately back. We would just say, oh, okay, well, here you go. You know, just take care of them. We don't want anything to do with this. And it sounds like these guys are going to have to face justice in Venezuelan courts. They may be traded, but it seems like the Venezuelan government takes violent attempts to overthrow it very seriously. And, you know, we're in an interesting situation.
Who do they think they are to take violent attempted coup d'etats against their government? Oh, seriously, those darn Venezuelans. And this guy, Juan Guaido, seeming to be the mastermind behind the plan, he confirmed allegedly has confirmed the identities of Luke Denman and Aaron Berry. And Guaido is a former Green Beret who founded private Florida-based mercenary force Silver Coup in 2018. When you start connecting these dots, it seems to point directly to U.S.-paid mercenaries tried to overthrow the president of Venezuela, Nicolas Maduro.
Well, it's interesting because Betsy DeVos, who is Trump's Secretary of Education and is one of major backer of the Trump movement, the Trump campaign, the DeVos Foundation is a major funder of a lot of conservative outlets from like PragerU to Turning Points USA and such. And Betsy DeVos, she's directly tied to these military contractors. Her brother is Eric Prince of the Blackwater Academy military contracting company. And it's interesting because if a private military contractor does something, the USA can deny involvement, right? If this had been active duty U.S. personnel, Venezuela would have said, oh, the United States actively tried to invade us. This is an act of war. But now you have kind of deniability because these are contractor corporations. I have a wild story, which is that I encountered a large number of U.S. military contractors when I was on a humanitarian mission to Yemen. I went with the Iranian Red Crescent Society to try and deliver humanitarian aid to Yemen. We were on a ship for 13 days. We weren't able to get to Yemen and dock in the port of Hodeida because it was bombed 8 times in a single day by the Saudis. As we were, you know, we ended up going to Djibouti, and I was able to get off the ship because the Iranians on the ship weren't able to get off. They don't allow Iranians in Djibouti, but because I had a U.S. passport, I got off the ship in Djibouti. And I went into the hotel to buy my my airline ticket. It was the only place you could buy an airline ticket in cash was in this hotel where the American Embassy is. And I'm in the middle. I had been in the Middle East. I'm in Africa for the first time, you know, and I walk into this hotel, and all of a sudden, I hear all these guys with West Virginia accents. And I'm in this hotel in Djibouti, you know, on the Horn of Africa there, and it's full of older, you know, or middle-aged white guys with big beards and wearing military fatigues. And I felt like I was back home in the United States. The breakfast buffet was all these military contractors, right? I guess Djibouti is a major hub for U.S. military contractors. These are guys who maybe drove a truck in the military or were active duty military or whatever. And after they get out of the military, they can make 6-figure salaries being private military contractors, meaning that they do the work of soldiers for a private corporation. It's pretty wild. And I guess one of the things that these guys do is try to overthrow the Venezuelan government, from what it appears.
You were kind of at the Costco of mercenaries there in Djibouti.
Yeah, indeed.
Corporate media had spread fake news claiming that North Korean leader Kim Jong-un had died. We now are seeing pictures of him. The original story was that he had had like quadruple bypass surgery and then was suffering complications from post-surgery complications. And now what we find out is he has resurfaced, never had surgery. And the stories that I've read indicate that he was really just distancing. He was practicing physical distancing. He was keeping himself away from people so he wouldn't get COVID-19.
You know, you have to wonder about this. With North Korea, they have a record of saying things that just aren't true. I had the honor when I was in college of meeting with Dr. Bruce Cummings, who is the leading Korea scholar in the United States. And he says he frequently gets calls from ABC News, NBC, MSNBC, U.S. media outlets, Fox, asking him to confirm a report that they've gotten about North Korea. There'll be claims that Kim Jong-un, you know, owns the world's largest collection of pornography. Kim Jong-un, you know, had a plan to kidnap this Hollywood actor, all this kind of stuff. And he will always say, "Of course, I can't confirm that." And then he'll ask them what their source is. And their source will either be someone in American intelligence or someone in South Korean intelligence. But often these news stories that have no basis, in fact, that are just something that came from some intelligence office or an anonymous source in the South Korean military or somewhere like that, get put on the front page, get plastered on the front page. I've seen news articles claiming North Korea believes in unicorns. That's malarkey, and that was refuted. I've seen claims that that Kim Jong-il claims he invented the hamburger, and North Koreans believe he invented the hamburger. This isn't true. But a lot of things about North Korea that are fake news, that are not subject to scrutiny the way other things would, end up on the front page. If someone was claiming the kind of things that they claim about Kim Jong-un or his predecessors, that they claimed about U.S. President Donald Trump, people would take it with a grain of salt. They would dig into it. They would look into the facts. But with North Korea, there is no filter. They put out whatever they do. And often, I feel like there is some intention here, right? Perhaps the idea was that perhaps these rumors would filter into North Korea. And perhaps maybe dissident elements might think, oh, maybe he's dead. Maybe this is our time to move. And perhaps they could create instability in the country. This isn't simply deception or speculation. I see some foul play at work here with this fake news story that's been completely debunked now. Everyone was saying Kim Jong-un is dead, North Korea is overthrown, and now we see there was nothing to it. He didn't have surgery. He wasn't even ill. Nothing happened.
Well, and this also ties to the National Endowment for Democracy, which is a CIA cutout operation that was created during the Reagan administration to push regime change against foreign countries, and they seem to be paying organizations in Seoul to produce this type of mis and disinformation.
Indeed, you know, something must be said here, which is that, you know, the U.S. media is very vicious and spread all kinds of rumors about Fidel Castro. U.S. media has been very nasty to Maduro. It's been very nasty to various anti-imperialist and Marxist leaders around the world. But the way North Korea is singled out for this kind of ridicule and fake news deception is particularly vicious. And it fits a trope among racists. If you go back, if you look back, the previous century, it was very common for commentators in the New York Times and mainstream U.S. publications to refer to Asiatic despotism or Asian despotism. And it was this notion that the peoples of Asia, they're not civilized like white people. They don't understand democracy and human rights. They are Asiatic despots. They're Genghis Khans, right? And it fits this trope, this racial trope that we see play out in a number of ways. I mean, the way China was viciously demonized for its efforts to enforce social distancing, efforts that worked, that got the COVID-19 situation under control, fit this paradigm as well. And the demonization of people from Asia as if they are authoritarian, as if they are robots. I mean, this is a racist white European trope we've seen in media quite a bit. And North Korea has been the major target of it.
Caleb Maupin, as always, sir, thank you so much for your time. Thank you for your analysis. Look forward to having you back.
Sure thing. Always a pleasure.
Thanks, man. Folks, you're listening to The Critical Hour here on Radio Sputnik. I'm your host, Dr. Wilmer Leon. There is more on the other side. Stay tuned.